Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure for me to give this distinguished talk here and to tell you about a field which is 200 years old and still very relevant. And this is essentially what I will try to explain to you. My talk has four parts, and parts is mathematically, and part is just history and applications. So in a few words, my background, almost exactly 50 years ago, I was finishing high school, visiting then or attending the university and being confronted with a very abstract course in mathematics. Already in the third semester, I learned about Fourier series, and this was a very abstract but fascinating subject, and I had no idea about applications. Later on, I was becoming a teacher, and then I realized what we are doing in theory is related to some applications. I should contact the applied people. And meanwhile, I'm retired and still talking about the applications and the theory and how they are connected and how fascinating everything is. I did a lot of European projects, which I think is a very valuable, was a very valuable part of my career, because it brought me into contact with other people and was giving funding for good scientific work. And I'm still, for almost 20 years, the editor of the Journal of Fourier Analysis and Applications. So despite the fact that Fourier analysis started with a paper by Fourier in 1822, it's part of modern technology. I think even the recording that is done currently would not be possible in the way it is done without Fourier analysics. Also, mathematics students rarely hear much about the theory that is behind those recordings, and engineers learn about formulas without seeing the mathematical theory, but this is a different subject. In principle, mathematics is perceived by many students, especially those who are not mathematical students, as a subject which is mysterious and complicated or so. And I think it's one of the things that one should teach, that it's relevant, that you can understand it. Like climbing mountains is fun for those who are well conditioned. And so I think you have to have a good condition training, which is study mathematics. Now, the history began with Fourier, and in Wikipedia you find this picture. And in the second part, I will talk about Gabor analysis, which is related to Danish Gabor, who was a Nobel Prize winner for physics applications in 1971. And I will tell you how these things are connected, but I hope you're still curious to see what's going on. Now, what is the Fourier series, or how did Fourier series theory start? It started with harmonic analysis. So you have the harmonic functions cosine and sine, and they are called harmonic because they share a common period. On that slide I have just displayed using GeoGebra how these functions look like. In the dynamic program you could change the frequency and see how they are narrow oscillating, which is high frequency, not so much oscillating, low frequency. And the problem of approximating a given periodic function, in this case an integer period, can be solved in some way by saying you have to write this partial sum Sn. It looks as it stands here. And there's even a formula that tells you how to obtain these coefficients An and Bn. Now, in words, Fourier was saying every periodic function has an expansion in this way. So if you write the infinite sum, this was the statement. And this was also part of my course. But with the extra comment, I should take this expansion in a formal way, after I had learned that what is a series? A series is a limit of partial sums. So somehow, why should I take it only in a formal way? And later understood, and we will talk about this in a moment. So the questions that are clear is, somebody talks about an infinite sum. Well, you take the partial sums and take the limit. These are functions. Well, what are functions at that time? It's not so clear. You are having piecewise polynomials maybe or so. So people had to think, what is a function? Then they had to think, what is an integral? What is a good integral? Riemann integral are nice, but Lebesgue integral is better, and so on. So these were all the questions, and still somehow, if you look into an engineering book, you find statements like Fourier series theory is very important, but also still mysterious. And it's a bit mysterious because of the focusing on this problem of pointwise convergence. Now, I talk about a little bit about the history. So what is the context of Fourier? It was at the time of Gauss. And we all know that Gauss was a genius, but he was also basing his work about complex numbers or so on another genius, namely Euler. So Euler's formula is displayed here. You can write the exponential function with an irrational basis, imaginary exponent, and you get two parts. One is the cosine and the sine. So these are the building blocks for Fourier analysis. What you have to introduce is this imaginary number. Now, mathematicians have found out without hocus pocus to define it as pairs of real numbers and define a calculus. And then you can form polynomials with complex coefficients. So you know what the square of a complex number is, you do linear combinations, then you have polynomials. And then you can even ask, maybe I can take a limit of these polynomials, and then you have decent expansions of the exponential function. And with this expansion, it's not so difficult actually, even numerically, with, I mean, taking the first 10 terms of some small number to verify that you have approximately and in the limit perfectly the exponential law, which is a much more elegant way to prove addition theorems for cosine and sine compared to the geometric way of doing it. But these are the things that were existing at that time. And I can go back. So at that time, people knew a little bit about power series, so Taylor expansion were existing, but the kind of expansion that Fourier was suggesting was really quite different from the one. So I'm coming back to my question of Fourier series expansion. What is the integral that one should choose? What kind of functions can be integrated? What can we say about the coefficients? Will they be arbitrary large or small or so? And nowadays we can say, yes, the Riemann integral is a very good first method. Every continuous function can be plugged into this thing. And you will see that if you have a smooth function, then a smooth function is almost like a constant function. If you integrate against an oscillating function, the up and downs are almost canceling out. So a smooth function will have Fourier coefficients which go to zero very quickly. Or you can say if you only take few Fourier coefficients, then you have a smooth function. And if the rest is very small, then the function also will be very smooth. So these are first principles. Now I have to jump a little bit more about the historical view. So before all this, we had the development of differential calculus, so differentiation was possible. And with Riemann, we had the correct form, the first form of a good integral. But then came Lebesgue. And if you look at Fourier series books in the early 20th century, they contain almost all the theory that we have now, a little bit more complicated or so. So didactically, things have improved. But the content is quite the same. And I will mention later Wiener, Norbert Wiener, and André Weil. So the key point is, in which sense do the partial sums converge? I'm jumping over this very quickly. Dirichlet was the first who said, well, this has to be treated. We have to prove it, and it's still a very, very good criterion in the sense of sufficient condition. While Kolmogorov, about 100 years later, found out that with the right integral, with the Lebesgue integral, you have the right space for the defining the Fourier coefficients, but you can have the worst possible scenario. You can have an L1 function where every point is a problematic point, and so, I mean, somehow, is then the Fourier series expansion useless? And the answer is no, not at all. You have just to find the right environment to have a good condition. Now, here comes a relationship to Pécs, because Lippold Feyer was born here, as far as I know. And he somehow, found out that if you look at the partial sums, they are not nice, but the deviations are kind of changing in different directions, apparently. So if you take an average of those partial sums, so what is called Cicero summability, then you're much better off. So he introduced methods of summability, and I would say it's a good example of a change of the perspective. You should look at the series not as a formal thing, but just a sequence of coefficients. And the question is, if you have this information, can you come back to the function? Nobody forces you to take partial sums. So this idea of turning on up to some point and then cutting off is one method. Feyer was saying, take more and more of the relevant coefficients, and then it works in a relatively fine way. So for example, you have uniform convergence for continuous functions. I was putting together some slides about the bibliography because they show a lot of interesting things, or I've chosen some of those. The first is this rough history that I mentioned already, Fourier, 1822, Kolmogorov counterexamples more than 100 years later. Hungarian contributions. So in the early 20th century, substantial contributions came from the Ries brothers, Marcel and Frederick Ries. So Szeged is still an important place. I saw that there is a celebration soon coming up here. You also see that all these articles have been written in German language. So it's also remarkable, I found at least. Now, jumping into the history of the 20th century, we have Fourier's, Lebesgue's theory. But it also went on by saying, well, we can do now Fourier transform for the continuous real line, for images, for Rn, for more general groups, periodic groups or so. So André Weil was the person pushing things into the most general situation of locally compact abelian groups. Laura Schwarz was saying, well, these symbols with the Dirac and more, that has to be put in the framework, the theory of tempered distributions. That was used by Hermander for partial differential equations. Everything in that area lives on Fourier analysis. And then came the numerical part with the FFT and Kulin-Taki. I will jump on this. Now I will be very brief. The beginning of Fourier analysis of the 20th century was also the beginning of functional analysis as we know it now. So the LP spaces are the prototypes of these spaces. In the 80s, they were looking back, so there are, again, four articles about the history of early functional analysis with a lot of hints to Fourier analysis. And it all came with the Fourier integral, and I leave out the details here. The Fourier integral is given by an integral transform and the inverse by another integral transform. And it's not obvious that just by the name, one is the inverse mapping to the other one. One has to sit down and prove it. But this can be done, fortunately. And engineers are happy about the energy preservation theorem, also known as Poincaré's theorem. So the L2 norm of a function and its Fourier transform are the same. In a nutshell, one nowadays talks a lot about continuous expansion systems. So you can say here in this red formula, that the Fourier expansion says you can synthesize in a very smeared way the function from the correlations from the scalar products with this continuous system, but this guy is not L2, it's not L1, it's going to infinity. These are the pure frequencies, sorry. And so somehow it's a formal thing, and I understand that one tries to avoid discussions of technical details. Now, last comment in this section is when you go to the harmonic analysis on general locally compact group, the name Alfred Haar is very important. He moved in the same way as Frederick Ries to Szeged in the early 20th century. And he found out that on any locally compact group, you can find the Haar measure, which is again the basis for defining the L1 spaces and so on. So also for what I talk later, this will be a basis. Now, the theory of tempered distribution is quite important, quite nice, and I can only give you one formula. That's, so to say, the trick how to define the Fourier transform of a tempered distribution. A tempered distribution is a functional of a kind, I call it sigma. And how can you define the Fourier transform of such a sigma, so the sigma hat? And the trick is, well, you have to apply it to a test function f. And the trick is take the test function, move it to the Fourier transform side, verify that it's again a test function, and then you get magically some formula. Now, I use very often in my talks pictures of this kind where I try to explain how different function spaces, distribution spaces, are contained one in the other. And here the curly object in the middle is the Schwarz space of rapidly decreasing functions. These are where the test functions are, and the curly object on the outside are the temporal distributions. So it shows everything that I'm talking is happening can be explained inside the temporal distribution, but I guess you will agree that this object is more complicated than this one, which is the space of mild distributions, which is the dual of an easier space here, which is the Siegel algebra is zero, and some people call it Feichtinger algebra. So you have all these function spaces. I don't go into the details, but I think orientation in a landscape is done by looking at maps, and so such a thing helps you to get a feeling where which spaces you have. For example, L1 is rotated by 90 degrees, the Fourier algebra. It's not Fourier invariant, whereas the circled spaces like L2, they are Fourier invariant, even fractional Fourier invariant. You can rotate by arbitrary angles. But now, I jump to the basis for digital signal processing, which is Poisson's formula translated into the statement that the Dirac comb, the sum of the Diracs under that abstract Fourier transform is this, and it can be used to prove the Shannon sampling theorem, which is the representation of a smooth function from the samples on this of a sum. So the proof is this. This is the function. That's your musical signal. You're sampling it. So instead of having the spectrum, you have a copy of the spectrum. But everybody can easily see that if you have this information, which is equivalent to this one, you just cut out this part and you get the original one by taking an inverse Fourier transform. This trick is the basis for the CD players, as we will see in a moment. I have to skip probably the part on the FFT. So it's a good way to compute the discrete version of the Fourier transform. It can be explained using the theory of fundament matrices, polynomials or so, and it has an efficient implementation due to Kuhle and Taki. Now, this is a slide more or less provocative telling you where in your life are you using Fourier transform theory, and the answer is every day you're using your mobile phone, you're listening to music and so on. So you're using your computer to send something to the printer and so on and so on. So the CD player records the sampled signal at the rate of 44,100 samples, which is a little bit more than 2 times 20,000. And 20,000 is the frequencies that nobody can hear. So people at my age probably are lucky if they hear 10,000, young people maybe 12 to 15,000 or so. So this is this theory is the basis for CD players. This is part of a visualization of the Windows Media Player. We're using mobile phones, we're sending WAV files for music, MP3 files for compressed music and so on, JPEG pictures and so on. I leave out the part about tomography and jump to this picture, which is a spectrogram. Now I'm coming to the work that Gabor was suggesting. He was saying we should not look at the time signal or the frequency signal, but we should take a joint frequency joint time frequency viewpoint. In a way, for a musician, this is not surprising, because this is how musicians code in a very efficient way a piece of music. If I play that piece of music and compute it, the spectrogram, it looks roughly like this. Now you say it's not so easy, but it's clear because you're not playing with a simple synthesizer which has one tone, but you have overtones, so you see things in parallel. We can afterwards take a look into this in real time. There is a Gaborator, which is really a website where you can upload your WAV file and can take a look, and it looks like this. This is a Bach piano recording, which is really very much telling you what kind of keys, what kind of overtones have been playing. I was looking some recording at YouTube. This is Bartok Piano Concerto, interesting piece. This is a fancy piano by Gergely Bogani, as I found out recently. And he's playing some Mozart piano concerto. So what is the idea? The idea is you cannot take the whole piece of music, but you're chopping the piece of music into pieces. These pieces are such that the sum of the pieces is again the signal. So you multiply with something which is saying, what is the frequency content now? So kind of, what is the accord played now? And then, and then, and then. So then we have a sequence of little blocks. Then we take the Fourier transform of this. And then we store this information or visualize this information as a picture, as a profile in the vertical direction. The MP3 coder, the one that helps you to compress your musical files, is saying, well, if you see that spectrogram, frequencies which are near important frequency cannot be heard. This has to do with our auditory system. So there is a combination of computer science, mathematics, psychoacoustic or so. And we use the compressions and store the relevant part. So I think it's usually for me like, take the spectrogram and try to play Mikado. Take to pull out part that don't change the outer shape of the thing. So Radon was Apan. Not Gabor was the person who was suggesting this in 1946. And it was very interesting that it took about, he was saying, take the Gauss function, shift it by integers, multiply each of those functions, so I take a few of them, with certain frequencies. So for me, this is like, take a cheap synthesizer who produces sound like duh, 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 at different places. And now, with this synthesizer and infinitely many fingers and a good programmer, you can play any sound, any given sound. Now, in a way, he was almost right. So one can have a whole course on this subject or so. It was very stimulating, but it was coming into mathematics only in the late 80s. So in the time frequency pictures, these are the concentrations of these building blocks, so it's very easy. And he was arguing why one should use this so-called critical lattice. I leave out these arguments here. But in the sparse case, it's like playing an accord and then another accord slowly so that you can decipher it. Then you can use this kind of strategy for communication. Mobile communication is working in this way. And in the other case, you're trying to write a function as a superposition of these building blocks. Now, he was troubled, if you look at what we do nowadays, we take slightly redundant systems, so we're not taking 40,000, we're taking 44,100, so to say, 10% more. The coefficients are not unique anymore. Is this a problem? If I give you 7 samples of a cubic polynomial, but they are not exact, you would say, oh, okay, thank you, I try to fit the best polynomial. So in that sense, here you would take among the infinitely many solutions the cheapest one, and that gives you a good representation. Now, why are these coefficients interesting? Because, again, I will jump, you can manipulate them. The coefficient at a given time is like the information that the audio engineer has. He may say, well, the high frequencies are not strong enough, I have to emphasize them more. Or the bass is too strong, I put it down. So if you take the position of the slider at each moment in time, so each time I take a new window, you are allowed to choose new windows. You shouldn't change it quickly, but then you have what is called a Gabor multiplier. And the study of Gabor multipliers, the inversion of Gabor multipliers is quite easy. Now, a few slides about the same thing in two dimensions. In two dimensions, the analog of pure frequencies are plane waves. So they are profiles which are cosine, sine. In each direction, you multiply them out, you get a plane wave. A pattern where plane waves in different directions are dominant are something like this. So that would be a good test image for 2D Gabor analysis or a zebra, where you also would say, in this part of the image, the stripes are having some coarseness, some frequency, so to say. This is not so fine at the belly or so, it's much finer at the other, and it has an orientation. So you have a 4-dimensional space or so, but we are just computing these things and then we can do things. So the difference or the building blocks are localized blobs which have a dominant frequency. Now, I'm not sure, I think I've skipped this part, but I should mention, this is similar to the JPEG compression algorithm, but in the JPEG compression algorithm, you're cutting out from your image segments of 8x8, and then you take a next, and then takes the next. So, of course, you can take a compression by taking only a few of these coefficients, but this square and this square have nothing to do. So if you're doing it, if you're doing a strong compression, you see the boundaries of the images. Here, if you leave out some of these terms, everything is smooth. So it will be a little bit overlapping. It has to overlap, otherwise you cannot do it. But the partial sums are smooth functions. And we all know that if you want to approximate a straight line, to approximate it with a zigzag line is usually not such a good idea. It's much better to have straight lines in different orientations. So somehow this is what we can do here. Now, I was giving an extended version of this talk almost 2 years ago in Prague. And luckily enough, 2 days before my talk, there was a breaking news. The Nobel Prize for Physics was given to a team of people who were detecting gravitational waves. So what I want to mention is, you have to be enormously optimistic that you can do it. And then you have to find people who are building these big instruments or so. And you're getting enormous amounts of data. But then in those data, you have to search for something like this. But you don't know exactly what the parameters are. From the physics, you think that certain signals are very likely. So I think they had 250,000 signals and they were trying to detect them. That strategy didn't work out because the first detected was larger than the expected family. But with time frequency methods, they were just blindly searching for in a different way for this. And this is a method called Wilson basis, which was successful in detecting this. The second one was then found with the original method. And I just heard in April they had a new series of measurements where not just the collision of two black holes was successfully detected, but also other events. So theoretical physics, again, 100 years ago was predicting things that can be verified now with a complicated combination of things. Now, I don't bother you with the literature. You only see it's about late 2000, or around 2000. We had our first book in 1998 or so. It's already 20 years old. And the subject is really going strong. We can use the different signal processing methods to denoise signals. So if there's a recording and there is some coughing, some noise outside, you can say, well, it's in the picture at some part which is not relevant for the music that you would like to keep. So it's restoration. You can separate signals. You can do the compression with the MP3 code. I have mentioned this. And in my last slide, I would like to comment on a few aspects. So the first thing is, despite the fact that Fourier analysis is a rather old theory or so, and we should try to not always follow the historical way of doing it, saying you have to first learn Fourier series, then Fourier transform, then tempered distributions, and then the numerical realization. There's a shortcut to do it by saying, well, everybody in the mathematical study has to learn about polynomials and linear algebra. We can use mathematical software to simulate all this and then observe it has nice properties. And then with these nice properties, you can get a feeling what is true and even build, understand many parts of Fourier analysis, not for the most general and most fancy signals, but the ones which are Riemann integrable. This itself is, again, a good basis for our new approach, that's the last point, of building an alternative approach to distribution theory. So I'm really working now on a book project to say, well, we should be able to teach the engineers a course in Fourier analysis which is satisfying their needs. So we should not only tell them how exciting it is for mathematicians because they have different aspects. For that, we will use GeoGebra or MATLAB and so on. And overall, of course, it's very important that we cannot expect that the applied scientists are learning all the mathematics, but that the mathematicians are reaching out for the applied scientists. So that's number three in my list or so. That may be the most important one. I have started myself as a pure mathematician. I was curious enough to go into the applications. Very often I spent a lot of time with boring discussions, but sometimes there were things that really were exciting or so. And my recommendation to young people, because there are many young participants of this talk now, is, well, look around, ask the senior people what they are doing, what they would recommend, but then decide what is your own path or so. Because usually, I mean, I'm older as well. I have some experience or so, but the problems that I couldn't solve maybe are not the right problems for you, and your generation has other new problems. So I think every generation has to look for their own problems, but try to learn from those who have experience and who are not too much concentrated on their own subject or so. So reaching out both scientifically and geographically and connecting with other people is definitely a good idea. In this sense, I would like to thank you for your attention, and who is interested, I can show other things afterwards. Thank you.